The doctrine of the me. 中庸。The doctrine of the me. 原文。第一章。天命之谓性，率性之谓道，修道之谓教。道也者，不可虚于离也。可离，非道也。是故，君子戒慎乎其所不睹，恐惧乎其所不闻。莫见乎隐，莫显乎微，故君子慎其独也。喜怒哀乐之谓发，谓之中，发而皆中节，谓之和。中也者，天下之大本也，和也者，天下之达道也。至中和，天地未焉，万物欲焉。第二章。仲尼曰，君子中庸，小人反中庸。君子之中庸也，君子而时中，小人之反中庸也，小人而无忌惮也。第三章。子曰，中庸其志矣乎？民先能久矣。第四章。子曰，道之不行也，我知之矣，知者过之，愚者不及也。道之不明也，我知之矣，贤者过之，不孝者不及也。人莫不饮食也，先能知味也。第五章。子曰，道其不行矣夫。第六章。子曰，顺其大之也与。顺好问而好察而言，隐恶而扬善，执其两端，用其中于民，其斯以为顺乎？第七章。子曰，人皆曰，与之屈而纳诸虎，或陷阱之中而莫知之辟也。人皆曰，与之则乎中庸而不能其越守也。第八章。子曰，为之为人也，则乎中庸，得一善，则全权服因而服师之矣。第九章。子曰，天下国家可君也，绝路可辞也，白刃可导也，中庸不可能也。第十章。子路问强。子曰，南方之强与北方之强与易而强与宽容以教，不暴无道，南方之强也。君子居之，任荆轲，死而不厌，北方之强也。而强者居之，故君子和而不留，强哉矫。中立而不倚，强哉矫。国有道，不变塞焉，强哉矫。国无道，至死不变，强哉矫。第十一章。子曰，素隐形怪，后世有数焉，无弗谓之矣。君子遵道而行，半途而废，无弗能已矣。君子依乎中庸，顿事不见之而不悔，为圣者能之。第十二章。君子之道，废而已。夫妇之愚，可以与之焉，及其智也，虽圣人亦有所不知焉。夫妇之不孝，可以能行焉，及其智也，虽圣人亦有所不能焉。天地之大也，人犹有所憾。故君子与大，天下莫能载焉；与小，天下莫能破焉。诗云：“渊非立天，于月于渊。”言其上下察也。君子之道，造端乎夫妇，及其志也，察乎天地。第十三章。子曰：“道不远人，人之为道而远人。”不可以为道。 诗云：伐柯，伐柯，其则不远；执柯以伐柯，逆而视之，有以为远。故君子以仁治人，改而止。终如为道不远，失诸己而不怨，亦勿失于人。君子之道四，丘未能易焉。所求乎子以事父，未能也；所求乎臣以事君，未能也；所求乎弟以事兄，未能也；所求乎朋友先师之，未能也。庸德之行，庸言之谨，有所不足，不敢不勉；有余，不敢进。言故行，行故言，君子胡不躁躁耳。第十四章，君子素其位而行，不怨乎其外。素富贵，行乎富贵；素贫贱，行乎贫贱；素夷狄，行乎夷狄；素患难，行乎患难。君子无入而不自得焉。在上位不临下，在下位不远上。正己而不求于人，则无怨；上不怨天，下不尤人。故君子居易以四命，小人勤俭以侥幸。子曰：设有四乎君子，失诸正骨，反求诸其身。第十五章，君子之道，譬如行远必自耳，譬如登高必自卑。诗曰：妻子好合，如鼓瑟琴；兄弟既息，何乐且耽？以尔世家，乐尔妻堂。子曰：父母其顺矣乎？第十六章，子曰：鬼神之为德，其甚矣乎？视之而弗见，听之而弗闻，体悟而不可疑。使天下之人，其民甚服，以臣祭祀，洋洋乎如其上，如在其左右。诗曰：神之格思，不可度思，审可涉思，夫为之险，臣之不可掩如此夫。第十七章，子曰：顺其大孝也与？德为圣人，尊为天子，富有四海之内，宗庙享之，子孙保之。故大德，必得其位，必得其禄，必得其名，必得其寿。故天之生物，必因其才而独焉，故哉者培之，亲者富之。诗曰：家乐君子，献献令德，以民宜人，受禄于天，保佑命之，自天生之，故大德者必受命。第十八章，子曰：无忧者，其为文王乎？以王继位父，以武王位子，父作之，子述之。武王转大王，王继文王之序，一荣一而有天下，身不失天下之显明，尊位天子，富有四海之内，宗庙享之，子孙保之。武王莫受命，周公臣文武之德，追王大王，王继上四先公以天子之礼，斯礼也，达乎诸侯，大夫及士庶人。父为大夫，子为士，葬以大夫，祭以士。父为士，子为大夫，葬以士，祭以大夫。其之丧，达乎大夫；三年之丧，达乎天子。父母之丧，无贵贱义也。第十九章，子曰：武王、周公其达孝矣乎？夫孝者，善继人之志，善述人之事者也。春秋，修其祖庙，成其宗器，设其长衣，建其石石。宗庙之礼，所以续昭穆也， 续觉所以变贵贱也，续世所以变贤也，履仇下位上所以改贱也，厌毛所以续齿也。见其位，行其礼，奏其乐，敬其所尊，爱其所亲，视死如视生，视亡如视存，孝之至也。交涉之礼，所以是上帝也，宗庙之礼，所以似乎其先也。民乎交涉之礼，地常之义，治国其如是诸长乎？第二十章，哀公问政。子曰：文武之政，不在方策。其人存，则其政举；其人亡，则其政息。人道敏政，地道敏术。夫政也者，仆如也。故为政在人，取人以身，修身以道，修道以人。仁者仁也，亲亲为大；义者义也，尊贤为大。亲亲之杀，尊贤之等，礼所生也。故君子不可以不修身，思修身；不可以不事亲，思事亲；不可以不知人，思知人；不可以不知天。天下之达道五，所以行之者三。曰：君臣也，父子也，夫妇也，坤弟也，朋友之交也。五者，天下之达道也。知、仁、勇，三者，天下之达德也。所以行之者义也。或生而知之，或学而知之，或困而知之，及其知之，义也。或安而行之，或利而行之，或勉强而行之，及其成功，义也。子曰：好学近乎知，力行近乎仁，知耻近乎勇。知思三者，则之所以修身；之所以修身，则之所以治人；之所以治人，则之所以治天下国家矣。凡为天下国家有九经曰：修身也，尊贤也，亲亲也，敬大臣也，体群臣也，子庶民也，来百公也，容远人也，怀诸侯也。修身则道立，尊贤则不惑，亲亲则诸父坤弟不怨，敬大臣则不炫，体群臣则事之报礼重，子庶民则百姓劝，来百公则财用足，容远人则四方归之，怀诸侯则天下畏之。斋民慎服，非礼不动，所以修身也。去谄远色，见惑而贵德，所以劝贤也。尊其位，重其禄，同其好恶，所以劝亲亲也。官慎任使，所以劝大臣也；忠信重禄，所以劝士也；时时保敛，所以劝百姓也；日审月事，祭秉称事，所以劝百公也；送往迎来，嘉善而今不能，所以柔远人也；祭绝事，举废国，治乱时为朝聘以时，厚往而薄来，所以怀诸侯也。凡为天下国家有九经，所以行之者义也。凡事欲则立，不欲则废，言前定则不竭，事前定则不困，行前定则不就，道前定则不穷。在下位，不惑乎上，民不可得而治矣；惑乎上有道，不信乎朋友。不惑乎上矣，信乎朋友有道；不顺乎亲，不信乎朋友矣，顺乎亲有道。反诸身不成，不顺乎亲矣，成身有道；不明乎善，不成乎身矣。成者，天之道也；成之者， 人之道也。臣者，不勉而忠，不思而得，从容中道，圣人也。臣之者，则善而不直之者也。博学之，审问之，慎思之，明辨之，笃行之。有弗学，学之弗能弗错也。有弗问，问之弗知弗错也。有弗思，思之弗得弗错也。有弗辨，辨之弗明弗错也。有弗行，行之弗笃弗错也。人亦能之，几百之；人十能之，几千之。果能此道矣，虽愚必明，虽柔必强。第二十一章：自成名，谓之信；自名成，谓之教。成则名矣，名则成矣。第二十二章：为天下至诚，未能尽其性；能尽其性，则能尽人之性；能尽人之性，则能尽物之性；能尽物之性，则可以赞天地之化育；可以赞天地之化育，则可以与天地参矣。第二十三章：其次至趋，趋能有成，成则行，行则者，者则明，明则动，动则变，变则化，为天下至诚未能化。第二十四章：至诚之道，可以前之。国家将兴，必有争祥；国家将亡，必有妖孽。见乎失规，动乎四体，祸福将至。善，必先知之；不善，必先知之，故至诚如神。第二十五章：诚者，自诚也，而道，自道也。诚者，物之终始，不诚，无物。是故，君子诚之为贵。诚者，非自诚己而已也，所以诚物也。诚己，人也；诚物，知也，性之德也，和外内之道也，故识错之矣也。第二十六章：故至诚无习，不习则久，久则真，真则悠远，悠远则博厚，博厚则高明。博厚所以载物也，高明所以覆物也，悠久所以成物也。博厚配德，高明配天，悠久无疆。如此者，不见而彰，不动而变，无为而成。天地之道，可一言而尽也。其为物不二，则其生物不测。天地之道，博也，厚也，高也，明也，幽也，久也。今夫天，思昭昭之多，及其无穷也。日月星辰系焉，物复焉。今天的一撮土之多，及其广厚，载华岳而不重，震河海而不泄，万物载焉。今夫山，一卷石之多，及其广大，草木生之，禽兽居之，宝藏兴焉。今夫水，一勺之多，及其不测，远沱蛟龙于鳖生焉，或才直焉。诗云：“为天之命，于目不已。”盖曰天之所以为天也。于乎不显，文王之德之纯。盖曰文王之所以为文也，纯亦不已。第二十七章：大哉，圣人之道！洋洋乎，发育万物，俊极于天。悠悠大哉！礼仪三百，威仪三千，待其人而后行。故曰：苟不至德，至道不明焉。故君子尊德性而道问学，至广大而敬精微， 及高明而道中庸，温故而知新，敦厚以崇礼。是故居上不骄，位下不卑。国有道，其言足以兴；国无道，其莫足以容。诗曰：既明且哲，以保其身，其此之谓与？第二十八章。子曰：愚而好自用，见而好自专，生乎今之事，反古之道，如此者，哉及其身者也。非天子不义礼，不制度，不考文。今天下车同轨，书同文，行同伦，虽有其位，苟无其德，不敢作礼乐焉；虽有其德，苟无其位，亦不敢作礼乐焉。子曰：吾说下礼，其不足真也；吾学殷礼，有宋存焉；吾学周礼，今用之，吾从周。第二十九章。王天下有三众焉，其寡过矣乎？上焉者，虽善无争，无争不信，不信民服从；下焉者，虽善不尊，不尊不信，不信民服从。故君子之道，本诸身，真诸庶民，考诸三王而不谋，见诸天地而不备，执诸鬼神而无疑，百事以祀圣人而不惑。执诸鬼神而无疑，知天也；百事以祀圣人而不惑，知人也。是故君子动而是为天下道，行而是为天下法，言而是为天下则，远之则有望，近之则不厌。诗曰：在彼无恶，在此无赦，树基素业，以永终欲。君子未有不如此，而早有欲于天下者也。第三十章。仲尼祖述尧舜，宪章文武，上律天时，下习水土。譬如天地之无不载，无不复酬；譬如四时之错行，如日月之代明。万物并育而不相害，道并行而不相悖。小德川流，大德敦化，此天地之所以为大也。第三十一章。为天下至圣，未能聪明睿之，足以有灵也；宽裕温柔，足以有容也；发强刚毅，足以有直也；斋庄中正，足有静也；文理密察，足以有别也。朴薄渊泉而石出之，朴薄如天，渊泉如渊。见而明莫不敬，言而明莫不信，行而明莫不说。是以声名扬溢乎中国，诗集满末，舟车所至，人力所通，天之所覆，的之所载，日月所照，双目所对，凡有邪气者，莫不尊亲，故曰配天。第三十二章。为天下至诚，未能经纶天下之代经，立天下之大本，知天地之化育。夫焉有所以？谆谆其人，渊渊其渊，浩浩其天。苟不顾聪明甚之达天德者，其孰能知之？第三十三章。诗曰：一井上迥，恶其闻之者也。故君子之道，黯然而日彰，小人之道的然而日亡。君子之道，淡而不厌，简而文，温而理，知远之近，知风之字，知为之险，可与入得矣。诗云：前虽弗矣，亦恐之招。故君子内审不咎，无恶于志。 君子之所不可及者，其为人之所不见乎？诗云：香在耳室，尚不愧于屋漏。故君子不动而静，不言而信。诗曰：奏假无言，实名有真。故君子不赏而明劝，不怒而明威于府悦。诗曰：不显为德，百辟其行之。故君子笃恭而天下平。诗云：与怀明德，不大声以色。子曰：声色之余以化名，莫也。诗曰：德犹如毛，毛犹有伦。上天之载，无声无秀。至矣。第一章：天命之谓性，率性之谓道，修道之谓教。经义：上天赋予人们的直性叫做性，遵循本性而行动的准则叫做道，使道真于修明叫做教。道也者，不可虚于离也，可离非道也。是故君子戒慎乎其所不睹，恐惧乎其所不闻，莫见乎隐，莫显乎微，故君子慎其独也。经义：道是一时一刻不能离开的，如果可以离开，那就不成其为道了。因此，有良好品德修养的人，在不会被人看见的时候，也总是警惕谨慎的，在不能被人听到的地方，也总是惶恐小心的。在隐蔽的情况也不要表现出不好的行为，在细小的事情上也不要暴露出不良的思想。所以，品德良好的人在单独居处的时候更要谨慎小心。喜怒哀乐之谓八，谓之中，八而皆中节，谓之和。中也者，天下之大本也。和也者，天下之达道也。至中和，天地未焉，万物欲焉。经义：喜怒哀乐这些情感在还没有迸发出来的时候，这种状态叫做中。这些情感迸发出来而能够完全符合法度，这种情况叫做和。中是天下万事万物的根本，和是天下普遍通行法则。能够做到中和，那天地就会按正常秩序运行，万物就能生长发育。一 What is endowed by heaven is called the nature. To follow that nature is called the way. To cultivate the way is called culture.One cannot depart from his way for an instant. What can be departed is not a way. And man of moral integrity is always discreet and vigilant when he is beyond others' sight, apprehensive and cautious when beyond others' hearing.One should never misbehave even when he is in privacy, nor should he reveal evil intentions even in trivial matters. So an immoral person remains circumspect, especially when he is alone. Feelings like joy, anger, sorrow and happiness are in the state of the mind when they are kept in heart.They are in the state of harmony when expressed in conformity with moral standards. The me is the fundament of everything under heaven, and harmony the universal law. With the me and harmony, the earth moves orderly, and everything thereon grows and flourishes. 第二章。仲尼曰： 君子中庸，小人反中庸。君子之中庸也，君子而时中，小人之中庸也。注：朱熹《四书章句集注》说，王肃本作小人之反中庸也，臣子亦以为然，亦闻从之，小人而无忌惮也。今义仲尼说，品德高尚者的言行符合中庸原则，品德低下者的言行违背中庸原则。品德高尚者的言行符合中庸原则，因为他们是品德高尚的君子，做事时时符合法度。品德低下者的言行违背中庸原则，因为他们是品德低下的小人，做事总是肆无忌惮。二 said Confucius, a man of noble character speaks and conducts himself according to the doctrine of the Mi. Why can man of vile character speaks and conducts himself in violation of that doctrine? The man of noble character observes the doctrine of the Mi, as his high morality enables him to act in conformity with moral standards at all times. The man of vile character goes against that doctrine, as his degenerating morality causes him careless of all the rules of proprieties. 第三章。子曰：中庸其志矣乎？民先能久矣。今义孔子说，中庸之道真是至善至美呀。可惜长期以来，一般老百姓却很少能够做得到。三 said Confucius, the doctrine of the Mi is the acme of perfection.The pity is that it has long been seldom in the practice of the public. 第四章。子曰：道之不行也，我知之矣，知者过之，愚者不及也。道之不明也，我知之矣，贤者过之，不孝者不及也。人莫不饮食也，先能知味也。今义孔子说，中庸之道所以不能实行，其原因我已经知道了，这就是聪明的人超越了中庸的标准，而愚昧的人又达不到中庸的标准。中庸之道所以不能昭著，其原因我已经知道了，这就是贤明的人超越了中庸的标准，而不贤明的人又达不到中庸的标准。这就像没有人不吃不喝，但很少有人能真正品尝出其中的滋味一样。四 said Confucius, the doctrine of the Mi has not been practiced, the reason for which as I see is that the wise goes beyond the norm of the Mi.And the benighted fails to reach the standard of the Mi. The doctrine of the Mi has not been obvious, the reason for which as I see is that the virtuous goes beyond the norm of the Mi, and the unworthy fails to reach the standard of the Mi. Everybody eats and drinks, but few savor what they eat and drink.第五章。子曰：道其不行矣夫。今义孔子说，中庸之道大概是难以做得到的吧。五 said Confucius, it is probable that the doctrine of the Mi cannot be practiced without making efforts. 第六章。子曰：顺其大之也与？顺好问而好察而言，隐恶而扬善，执其两端，用其中于民，其斯以为顺乎？今义 孔子说，舜可算是个最有智慧的人了吧。他喜欢询问别人，又喜欢审查日常浅近的话，掩盖人们不好的言行，宣扬人们好的言行，掌握过激和不足两个方面，加以折中，施行于民众。这大概就是舜所以称其为舜的道理吧。六 said Confucius, 商亲号 may well be counted as a man of great wisdom. He was inquisitive and fond of investigating the ordinary popular language. He concealed others' misbehavior and publicized others' good deeds.What he did for the people was based on the mean he drew from the two extreme motives of things of diametric opposition. That explains why he was esteemed as Shang. 新号商 the legendary monarch of ancient China. 第七章子曰人皆曰与之屈而纳诸古或陷阱之中而莫知之辟也。人皆曰与之，则乎中庸而不能其越守也。经义，孔子说，人人都说我聪明，可是被人驱赶进了罗网陷阱，却不知道躲避。人人都说我聪明，可是既然选择了中庸之道，却又连恪守一个月的时间也做不到。七 said Confucius, everybody says, I am wise, but knows not to escape when driven to be trapped. Everybody says, I am wise, but abides not for a month the doctrine of the mean for which he has opted.第八章子曰为之为人也则乎中庸的一善则全权服因而服师之矣。经义孔子说言回为人选择了中庸之道只要明白一个好的道理就牢牢记在心上永远不把它丢掉。八 said Confucius,言为 as 新号 attitude toward life is to follow the doctrine of the mean. Once he learns a good doctrine, he bears it in mind and will never abandon it. 新号言为 one of the disciples Confucius taught personally. 第九章子曰天下国家可君也绝路可辞也白刃可导也中庸不可能也。经义孔子说天下国家可以立好官爵俸禄可以推辞掉白光闪闪的刀刃可以踏上去中庸之道却不容易做得到。九 said Confucius,The land under heaven can be administered to bring about great order across it. Official ranks and emoluments can be declined, and sharp blades with blazing edges can be trod. But the doctrine of the mean is not easy to practice.
第十章子路问强子曰南方之强与北方之强与义而强与宽柔以教不暴无道南方之强也君子居之任荆格死而不厌北方之强也而强者居之故君子和而不留强哉矫中立而不倚强哉矫国有道不变塞焉强哉矫国无道至死不变强哉矫经义 子路询问什么是坚强，孔子说，你问的是南方人的坚强呢，北方人的坚强呢，还是你自己这样的坚强呢？以宽厚柔顺的精神教诲别人，对抱怨无德的行为也不加报复，这是南方人的坚强，有良好品德修养的人安处此道，披坚执锐，死而无憾，这是北方人的坚强，性格强悍的人奉行此道。因此，有良好品德修养的人，平和柔顺，但又不随波逐流，这是多么坚强啊！国家政治清明的时候，不改变不得志时的志向，这是多么坚强啊！国家政治黑暗的时候，至死也不改变平时的操守，这是多么坚强啊！十 ，When asked by Zi Luxin how to define strength, replied Confucius, "Which are you seeking, the strength of the southerners, of the northerners, or of yourself?" The southerners are strong in that they teach people the gist of magnanimity and gentleness, and advocate dismissing revenge for others.Inflating atrocity. It is the way with which a man of integrity is content. The northerners are strong in that they buckle on their armors and take up weapons to go forth to bloody battles without fear of death. It is the way with which a man of intrepidity is content. Therefore,A man of good cultivation is placid and moderate, yet following no fashion but his own. That is genuine strength. He takes with impartiality the firm stand of the mean. That is genuine strength. If the government is upright and the state well governed,He cherished his aspirations he had when he was not in the ascendant. That is genuine strength. If the government is corrupt and the rule is dark, he still sticks to his normal course unto death. That is genuine strength.辛浩子路 one of the disciples Confucius spoke personally. 第十一章。子曰：素隐行怪，后世有数焉，无弗谓之矣。君子遵道而行，半途而废，无弗能已矣。君子依乎中庸，顿事不见之而不悔，为圣者能之。经义，孔子说，追求生僻的道理，好做出奇的事情，会得到后世的称道，但我不做这种事。品德修养好的人遵循中庸之道去做，有人半途而废，但我是不能停止的。品德修养好的人遵循中庸之道，即使隐居山林而不被世人了解也不后悔，这只有圣人才能够做到。十一 said Confucius, probing onto absurd and obscure senses and committing eccentricity, which may win appraisals from posterity, are what I shall never undertake.Among the men of good cultivation following the doctrine of the mean, some may give up halfway, but I shall not following it. Only the saints will not regret following the doctrine of the mean at the cost of remaining anonymous and unknown to the world. 第十二章。君子之道，备而隐。夫妇之愚，可以与之焉，及其智也，虽圣人亦有所不知焉。 夫妇之不孝，何以能行焉？及其志也，虽圣人亦有所不能焉。天地之大也，人犹有所憾。故君子与大，天下莫能载焉；与小，天下莫能破焉。诗云：渊非立天，鱼跃于渊。言其上下察也。君子之道，造端乎夫妇，及其志也，察乎天地。今义，品德高尚的人所奉行的处事准则，既普遍又深刻。一般道理，连愚笨的男男女女也可以了解。到高深精妙的地方，即使圣人也不能完全明白。一般准则，连不贤明的男男女女也能够做到。到高深精妙的地方，即使圣人也有做不到的。天地如此之伟大，人们尚且还有不满意的地方。因此，品德高尚的人说到道的博大，博大到天下简直无法负载得了他，说他细微，细微到天下没有什么再能够把它分割。诗经上说，要鹰飞向天空，鱼儿跳入深渊。这是比喻圣人之德在天地上下都是显明昭著的。品德高尚的人所奉行的处事准则，起始于普通男女之间的所作所为，到其最高深精妙之处，则能显赫于天地宇宙之间。十二 ，The philosophy of life, the man of high morality pursued is both common and profound. Its general idea is known to ignorant men and women, but its recondite quintessence is beyond the attainment of the saint.Its general standard is practicable to mediocre men and women, but its highest demand is beyond the reach of the saint. Great as the universe is, there are people who may feel discontent with it. Therefore, the virtue of a man of high morality is so vast that the universe can hardly contain it. It is also so tiny that nothing in the universe can cut it apart. It is said in the Book of Songs, Xin Ha, sparrowhawks fly up in the sky, fish swim down in the abyss.That is by way of analogy to say that the virtue of the saint is highly clear on the earth as well as in the sky. The philosophy of life the man of high morality pursue begins in the manners of the ordinary men and women, but its superlative manifestation is illustrious in the universe.Xin Hao, the Book of Songs, the earliest anthology of poems and one of the five classics. 第十三章。子曰：道不远人，人之为道而远人，不可以为道。诗云：伐柯，伐柯，其则不远；执柯以伐柯，逆而视之，有以为远。故君子以仁治人，改而止。今义，孔子说，中庸之道是不远离人的。如果一个人奉行中庸之道而使他远离了人，那就称不上是中庸之道了。诗经上说，随便砍块木头做斧柄，会觉得那尺寸相差不远。可是拿着斧柄去砍伐本头做斧柄，斜起眼睛仔细比照一番，倒会觉得还是相差很远。因此，统治者只能根据个人的情况治理人们， 人家改正了以前的错误就要作罢。终如为道不远，失诸己而不愿，亦勿失于人。今亦能够做到竭尽心力的中和推己及人的恕，这就离中庸之道不远了。凡是不愿意别人施加于自己的行为，也就不要施加于别人。君子之道四，丘未能已焉。所求乎子以事父，未能也；所求乎臣以事君，未能也；所求乎弟以事兄，未能也；所求乎朋友先师之，未能也。庸德之行，庸言之谨，有所不足，不敢不勉；有余，不敢进。言故行，行故言，君子胡不躁躁耳。今亦品德高尚者所奉行的行为准则有四条，我孔丘一条也没有做得到。用要求人子应有的行为去侍奉父亲，我没有做到。用要求人臣应有的行为去侍奉君王，我没有做到。用要求人弟应有的行为去侍奉兄长，我没有做到。要求朋友应该做到的自己首先去做，我没有做到。在遵守一般道德方面，在普通言谈的谨慎方面，做得不够的，不敢不努力去做；做得好的，也不敢把话说尽。说话时要想到行动如何，办事时也要想到说过的话。这样看来，作为一个有道德的人，怎么能不忠厚老实呢？十三 ，said Confucius, the doctrine of the mean never distances itself from any person. If anyone pursuing the doctrine makes it unapproachable to others,then what he pursues is by no means the doctrine of the mean. It's said in the Book of Psalms, cut a piece of wood to make a hearth, you will find its size fit. But when you squint to compare it with the hearth in your hand, you will find its size unfit. Therefore,the monarch of a country should rule over the people according to their individual conditions, and stop interfering in their conduct when their mistakes are corrected. One nears the doctrine of the mean when he is faithful to and considerate of others.What you would not have others do unto you should not be done unto them. The code of conduct and man of moral integrity pursues includes four requirements, but I can fulfill none. I do not wait upon my father as a son should. I do not wait upon the monarch as a subject should.I do not wait upon my elder brother as a younger brother should. I do not take the initiative to do what I demand of my friends. I dare not stop exerting myself to remedy my defects in observing moral standards and in speaking with prudence.I dare not say fine words even if I do observe moral standards and speak with prudence. Think of what you did when you speak, and think of what you said when you act. Therefore, a man of high morality should be no otherwise than honest. 第十四章，君子素其位而行，不愿乎其外。素富贵，行乎富贵；素贫贱，行乎贫贱；素夷狄，行乎夷狄；素患难，行乎患难。 君子无入而不自得焉。经义，品德高尚的人总是根据自己平常所处的地位而行动，不愿意超越本分。平常处于富贵地位的，就做富贵地位的人应该做的；平常处于贫贱地位的，就做贫贱地位的人应该做的；平常处在夷狄地区的，就做夷狄应该做的；平常处在患难境地的，就做患难之人应该做的。品德高尚的人无论处在什么地位，没有不是安分的。在上位不临下，在下位不圆上，正己而不求于人，则无怨。上不怨天，下不尤人，故君子居义以四命，小人勤俭以侥幸。子曰：设有四乎君子，失诸正骨，反求诸其身。经义，处在上位不欺凌处于下位的人，处在下位不高攀处于上位的人，端正自己的品行而不责求别人，这样便没有什么怨恨。对上不怨恨天命，对下不归咎别。因此，品德高尚的人处于平安的地位等待天命，品德低下的人行为冒险，妄图意外地获得成功或免除不幸。孔子说，射箭就像品德高尚者处事，如果射不中靶心，并不责怪别人，而是回过头来责备自己。14. A man of high morality acts in accordance with his status and seeks nothing beyond. If he is ordinarily wealthy and ranking, he does what a man of wealth and rank should do. If he is ordinarily straitened and humble, he does what a man of straits and humbleness should do. If he is ordinarily in the minority areas, he does what a minority should do. If he is ordinarily in adversity, he does what a man in adversity should do. A man of high morality knows and rests content with his place, whatever it may be. When he is superior in position, he never bullies anyone inferior to him. When he is inferior in position, he never fawns on anyone superior to him. As he corrects his own misbehavior and never makes excessive demands on others, he bears no resentment against them. He blames neither God when looking upward, nor other people when looking downward. Therefore, a man of noble character remains at ease in his ordinary place to wait the mandate of heaven, while a man of vile character ventures to fluke success or to avoid mishap. Said Confucius, shooting an arrow is analogous to a moral person, as handling affairs, if he misses the bull, as I, he reproaches no one but himself. 第十五章，君子之道，譬如行远必自耳，譬如登高必自卑。诗曰：妻子好合，如鼓瑟琴；兄弟既息，何乐且耽？以耳世家，乐而妻躺。子曰：父母其顺矣乎？经义，品德高尚者实践他的行为准则，好比走远路，一定要从近处启程；譬如登高处，必须从低处出发。诗经上说，妻子儿女感情好，如同琴瑟五音调。 兄弟相处好亲密，和睦愉快乐淘淘，让你家庭更美满，让你妻儿欢乐多。孔子说，像这样，父母就会顺心满意了吧。十五 ，An moral person as practicing his code of conduct can be compared to taking a long journey which must start from the immediately close point, or ascending a height which must begin from the bottommost ground. It is said in the Book of Psalms,Living affectionately with one's wife and children is like playing musical instruments harmoniously. Getting along fraternally with one's brother is highly delightful. May your family be happy. May your wife and children be joyous. Said Confucius.Parents will thus be satisfied. 第十六章。子曰：鬼神之为德，其甚矣乎？视之而弗见，听之而弗闻，体悟而不可疑。使天下之人，其民甚服，以臣祭祀，洋洋乎如其上，如在其左右。诗曰：神之格思，不可度思，审可设思，夫为之显，臣之不可掩如此夫。今义。孔子说，鬼神的德行真是伟大呀。看他看不见形体，听也听不到声音，但又生养万物魔所遗漏，使得天下的人都斋戒沐浴，穿戴整齐，举行祭祀，灵气浩荡，像在人的头顶，又像在人身旁。诗经里说，神的降临不可推测，怎么能够懈怠不恭呢？鬼神的威力从隐微到显著，他的诚信就是这样，不能掩盖呢。十六 ，said Confucius, how mighty the virtue of the supernatural being is. Though invisible when looked at, inaudible when listened to, its omnipresence nourishes everything under heaven, so that all people in the country abstain from meat and wine.Take bath and dress themselves up to offer sacrifice to it. People sense its existence as if it is above or around them. It is said in the Book of Psalms, the advent of the God is unpredictable, how can we slack our reverential awe?The might of the supernatural being permeates things obscure and obvious, its trustworthiness is so evident that it can never be concealed by any means. 第十七章。子曰，顺其大孝也与。德为圣人，尊为天子，富有四海之内，宗庙享之，子孙保之。故大德必得其位，必得其禄，必得其名，必得其寿。故天之生物必因其才而独焉，故哉者培之，亲者附之。诗曰：家乐君子，献献令德，以民宜人，受禄于天，保佑命之，自天生之，故大德者必受命。今义。孔子说，舜可算是顶孝顺的人了吧。论德行是圣人，论尊贵是天子，论富有则拥有四海之地，享受着宗庙的祭祀，子子孙孙永远保持祭祀不断。因此凡是具有极高德的人，一定会得到应有的尊位，一定会得到应有的厚禄，一定会得到应有的美名， 定会得到应有的高寿。因而上天生育万物，一定会根据他们各自的资质而认真处置，可以栽培的就培育他们，倾倒了的也就只能让他们倒下去。诗经里说，美善和乐周成王，赫赫圣德放光芒，好叫臣民俱安乐，受禄于天能久享。上天保佑又赐命，永保福禄万年长。所以凡具有极高德行的人，一定会承受天作天子。十七 said Confucius, some may be accounted as the most filial. In view of his virtue, he was a saint. In view of the esteem he gained, he was the sun of heaven. In view of his wealth, he possessed the whole world. He was and would ever be enshrined and offered sacrifices by posterity. So and none of consummate virtue is bound to have all he deserves, the respected status, the handsome emoluments, the good reputation and the long jeopardy. Heaven creates all things in the universe, and handles them with measures suited to their nature, to cultivate the cultivable and let the top off fall. It is said in the Book of Songs, how praiseworthy and pleasant King Chen of the Zhou Dynasty is, how glorious his merit is, he makes all his subjects live in peace and happiness. His reign, predestinated by heaven, lasts for long, his bounties, blessed by heaven, remain for aeon. Therefore, the man of consummate virtue is certainly to be the son of heaven by the grace of God. 第十八章。子曰：无忧者，其为文王乎？以王继位父，以武王位子，父作之，子述之。武王转大王，王继，文王之序。一荣一而有天下，身不失天下之显明，尊位天子，富有四海之内，宗庙享之，子孙保之。今义。孔子说，没有忧愁的人，大概只有周文王吧。他有父亲王继，有儿子武王，父亲开拓，儿子继承。武王继承太望古宫旦父王继文王的功业，灭了大殷王朝而得到天下，自身没有失去显赫的名声，尊则为天子，父则拥有四海，享受宗庙的祭祀，子子孙孙永保香火不断。武王莫受命，周公成文武之德，追王大王王继，上四先公以天子之礼。斯礼也，达乎诸侯，大夫即士庶人。父为大夫，子为士，葬以大夫，祭以士。父为士，子为大夫，葬以士，祭以大夫。其之丧，达乎大夫。三年之丧，达乎天子。父母之丧，无贵贱义也。今义。周武王晚年承天命做天子，武王死后，周公成就了文王和武王的功德，追加太望王继的帝王谥号，按天子的礼制祭祀先祖，这种礼制一直推行到诸侯大夫，以至世人百姓之中。如果父亲是大夫，儿子是士，父亲死了，埋葬就按照大夫的礼制，祭祀则按照士的礼制。如果父亲是士，儿子是大夫， 父亲死了，埋葬就按照士的礼制，祭祀则按照大夫的礼制。一年守丧期的规定，大夫也要遵守；三年守丧期的规定，天子也要遵守。给父母守丧的规定，不管地位尊卑，都是一样的。十八
，said Confucius, the only person free from all anxieties might be King Wen of the Zhou Dynasty, with meritorious deeds pioneered by his father Wang Ji and succeeded by his son King Wu. King Wu carried forward and forged ahead the exploits of Taiwan, Wang Ji and King Wen, and overthrew the Yin dynasty to win the rule over the country. He also retained a great renown. He was esteemed as the son of heaven, in possession of the whole world, to be enshrined and offered sacrifices by all the succeeding generations. After King Wu, Zhou Gong accomplished the great task of King Wen and King Wu, and conferred upon Taiwan and Wang Jing with posthumous titles as kings, and enshrined his ancestors with rights for sons of heaven. Rights of the same kind was later practiced among feudal dukes, princes, senior officials, Shi Xinghao, and the common people. Suppose the father was a senior official and the son a Shi, when the father died, his obsequies were celebrated with those for a senior official, and the enshrinement was thus celebrated by a Shi. If the father was a Shi and the son a senior official, then the obsequies were those for a Shi, and the enshrinement was thus celebrated by a senior official. The convention of 1 year mourning period was abolished by the senior officials. The convention of 3 year mourning period was abolished even by the son of heaven, and conventions of mourning period were abolished by all the noble and the humble. Xinghao Shi, the stratum between senior officials and common people.
第十九章，子曰：武王、周公其达孝矣乎？夫孝者，善继人之志，善述人之事者也。春秋，修其祖庙，成其宗器，设其长衣，见其时时。今义。孔子说，周武王和周公可算是通达孝道了吧？所谓孝，就是善于继承人造志向，善于继承先人的事业。春秋祭祀的时候，整修祖宗的庙宇，陈列祖传的器具，撮开祖先的衣服，贡献应时的食品。宗庙之礼，所以续朝暮也；续爵，所以变贵贱也；续事，所以变贤也；履仇下位上，所以改谏也；验毛，所以续齿也。今义，宗庙祭祀的礼节，是为了区别父子、长幼、亲疏的次序，按照爵位排列顺序；是为了分尊贵与卑贱，按照职务排列顺序；是为了区分贤与不贤。卑下者依次给长辈敬酒，是为了体现把恩典施加到卑下者身上。按照毛发颜色黑白排列宴饮的座次，是为了分别年龄大小。见其位，行其礼，奏其乐，敬其所尊，爱其所亲，视死如视生，视亡如视存，孝之至也。今义， 站到排定的位置上，施行先王的礼节，演奏先王的音乐，尊敬先王所尊敬的，热爱先王所热爱的，侍奉死去的就像侍奉活着的一样，侍奉不存在的就像侍奉存在的一样，真是孝顺到极点了。交涉之礼，所以是上帝也，宗庙之礼，所以似乎其先也。民乎交涉之礼，地常之义，治国其如是诸长乎？今义举行祭天的交礼和祭的的设礼，是为了敬奉天地；举行宗庙的祭祀，是为了祭祀自己的祖先。明白了，交涉地常等各种大小祭祀的礼和意义，那么治理国家大概就好像把东西摆在手掌上一样容易了吧。19 Said Confucius, King Wu and Zhou Gong were well versed in the true implication of filial piety. Filial piety means to carry out successfully the ideal and task of one's ancestors. When offering sacrifices to ancestors in spring and autumn,one should renovate the ancestral temple, display utensils and clothing left by the ancestors, and sacrifice foods in season. Ceremonial rules of offering sacrifices in the ancestral temple is for making distinction between the father and the son, the elder and the young, and the close and distant relatives, to arrange sequence according to ranks is for distinguishing the noble and the humble, to arrange sequence according to positions is for distinguishing the prominent and the mediocre.To let the juniors toast in proper order their seniors is for reflecting the grace bestowed on the inferiors, to assign the seats. At dinner according to the color of hair is for distinguishing the differences of seniority. One should stand on the assigned position.Observe the etiquettes set by the great kings of past dynasties, play their music, respect what they respected, and love what they loved. To attend on the dead as if to attend on the living, or to attend on the non-existent, as if to attend on the existent, is the utmost of filial piety.Rites to offer sacrifices to heaven and earth are celebrations dedicated to God. To offer sacrifices in ancestral temple is to worship one's ancestors. If people understand the significances of different rites, such as offering sacrifices to heaven and earth,Rites celebrated in the imperial ancestral temple and the autumn sacrificial ceremony, administering the country will be as easy as seeing things in one's palm. 第二十章，哀公问政。子曰：文武之政，不在方策。其人存，则其政举。其人亡，则其政息。人道理政，地道理术。夫政也者，仆如也。故为政在人，取人以身，修身以道，修道以人。今义鲁哀向孔子询问治理政事方面的事。孔子说，周文王、周武王的政令都记载在各种典籍里。那圣君贤臣在，那文王、 武王的政令就能施行，那些圣君贤臣没有了，那文王、武王的政令也变废止。用人坚持的法则是肯努力办理政事，种地坚持的法则是肯努力栽培草木，这样政事就会像芦苇容易生长一样，不难治理。所以为政之道，关键在于有贤人。要想得贤人，就必须搞好自身修养，要想搞好自身修养，就必须按照天下通行的准则进行，要想做按天下通行的准则办事，就必须遵循仁爱的原则。仁者，仁也，亲亲为大，义者，义也，尊贤为大。亲亲之杀，尊贤之等，礼所生也。故君子不可以不修身，思修身，不可以不事亲，思事亲，不可以不知人，思知人，不可以不知天。经义，仁的意思也就是仁。亲近爱戴自己的亲人是最大的仁。义的意思也就是义，尊重贤者是最大的义。在亲近爱戴亲人方面的差别，在尊重贤者方面的差别，都是由礼节的要求而产生的。因此身居统治地位的人不能不搞好自身修养，要想搞好自身修养，就不能不侍奉父母，要想侍奉好父母，就不能不知道关于尊贤爱人方面的道理，要想了解关于尊贤爱人方面的道理，就不能不知道关于天道方面的学问。天下之达道五，所以行之者三，曰君臣也，父子也，夫妇也，昆弟也，朋友之交也。五者，天下之达道也，知仁勇。三者，天下之达德也，所以行之者义也。或生而知之，或学而知之，或困而知之，及其知之义也。或安而行之，或利而行之，或勉强而行之，及其成功义也。经义，天下通行的伟大准则有五个方面，赖以实行的品德有三点：君臣关系、父子关系、夫妇关系、兄弟关系、朋友交往。这五个方面是天下通行的伟大准则。智慧、仁爱、勇敢，这三点是天下通行的伟大品德，而赖以实践这些伟大品德的条件则是一样的。这些有的人天生就知道，有的人学习以后就知道，有的人处困境以后才知道，但当他们知道以后，其结果则是同样的。有的人是心安理得的实行，有的人是为谋求好处而实行，有的人是勉勉强强的实行，但当他们成功以后，其结果则是同样的。子曰：好学近乎知，力行近乎仁，知耻近乎勇。知思三者，则之所以修身，之所以修身，则之所以治人，之所以治人，则之所以治天下国家矣。经义，孔子说，喜欢学习就接近智慧了，努力行善就接近仁爱了，知道羞耻就接近勇敢了。知道这三条，那就知道该怎样加强自我修养，知道怎样加强自我修养，那就知道该怎样治理众人，知道怎样治理众人， 那也就知道怎样治理天下、治理国家了。凡为天下国家有九经曰：修身也，尊贤也，亲亲也，敬大臣也，体群臣也，子庶民也，来百公也，容远人也，怀诸侯也。修身则道立，尊贤则不惑，亲亲则诸父坤弟不怨，敬大臣则不炫，体群臣则事之报礼重，子庶民则百姓劝，来百公则财用足，容远人则四方归之，怀诸侯则天下畏之。今义大凡治理天下国家有九条准则，这便是加强自我修养，尊重贤人，热爱亲人，敬重大臣，体恤重臣，爱民如子，招来各种工匠，对边远地区的人民实行怀柔政策，安抚各国诸侯。能够加强自我修养，崇高的道德准则就能树立起来，能够尊重贤人，遇到问题就不会迷惑，能够热爱亲人，伯叔兄弟就不会有怨恨，能够敬重大臣，办事就会不糊涂，能够体恤重臣，世人就会加倍报答，能够爱民如子，百姓们就会自觉努力，能够招来各种工匠，财富货物就会充足，对边远地区的人民实行怀柔政策，四方边境的人民就会归顺，安抚各国诸侯，天下人就会敬畏，斋民慎服，非礼不动。所以修身也，去谄远色，见货而贵德。所以劝贤也，尊其位，重其禄，同其好恶。所以劝亲亲也，官慎任使。所以劝大臣也，忠信重禄。所以劝士也，时时保敛。所以劝百姓也，日审月事，祭秉称事。所以劝百公也，送往迎来，嘉善而今不能。所以柔远人也，既绝世，举废国，治乱时为朝聘以时，后往而薄来，所以怀诸侯也。凡为天下国家有九经，所以行之者义也。经义内心虔诚，外表端庄，不符合理智的事不做，这是自我修养的方法。摒除爱说别人坏话的小人，远离漂亮的女子，轻视财物而重视品德，这是劝勉贤人的方法。让他们的爵位尊崇，增加他们的俸禄，同他们好恶一致，这是劝勉热爱亲人的方法。为大臣多设下属官员而足以驱使，这是劝勉大臣的方法。讲究忠诚信守，俸禄丰厚，这是劝勉世人的方法。一使事实，轻征赋税，这是劝勉百姓的方法。天天审查，月月考核，付给的粮食工薪同他们付出的劳动相称，这是劝勉工匠的方法。走的欢送，来的迎接，嘉奖行为好的，同情能力差的，这是对边远地区人民进行怀柔的方法。让已经绝后的世系得以延续，振兴已经没落了的邦国，治理动乱，扶持危难，朝见聘问按时举行，多给赏赐，少要纳贡，这是安抚诸侯的方法。治理天下国家的准则有九条，而赖以实行这些准则的条件则是相同的。凡事欲则立，不欲则废，言前定则不竭，事前定则不困，行前定则不就，道前定 则不穷。今亦任何事情，事前有准备就能成功，没有准备就会失败。说话前预先想定，就不会语塞；事情发生前预先想定，就不会遭受挫折；行动前预先想定，就不会有什么毛病；行为原则预先想定，就不会走投无路。在下位，不惑乎上，民不可得而治矣；惑乎上有道，不信乎朋友；不惑乎上矣，信乎朋友有道；不顺乎亲，不信乎朋友矣，顺乎亲有道。反诸身不成，不顺乎亲矣，成身有道；不明乎善，不成乎身矣。今亦处在下位而不能得到处上位者的信任，那就不能够治理好人民。要得到处上位者的信任是方法的，如果不被朋友信任，也就是不到处上位者的信任了。要取得朋友的信任是有方法的，如果不顺从父母，也就得不到朋友的信任了。要能够顺从父母是有方法的，如果自身不诚实，也就不能够顺从父母了。要想自身诚实是有方法的，如果不明白什么是善，自身也就不能诚实了。诚者，天之道也；诚之者，人之道也。诚者，不勉而终，不思而得，从容中道，圣人也。诚之者，则善而不直之者也。博学之，审问之，慎思之，明辨之，笃行之。今亦诚实，这是自然的法则；做到诚实，这是为人的法则。自然的诚实，不用勉强便能做到，不用思索便能达到，自然而然就能符合准则，人能做到这样。让人们做到诚实，则要选择善道而坚守不渝。要广博的学习，详细的询问，谨慎的思考，清楚的辨别，忠实的实行。有福学，学之弗能弗错也；有福问，问之弗知佛错也；有福思，思之弗得弗错也；有福辨，辨之弗明弗错也；有福行，行之弗笃弗错也。人一能知，几百知；人十能知，几千知。果能此道矣，虽愚必明，虽柔必强。今亦要博不学习，既然学习，学不会就不罢休；要磨不询问，既然询问，弄不懂就不罢休；要磨不思考，既然思考，没有收获就不罢休；要磨不辨别，既然辨别，不辨别清楚就不罢休；要磨不实行，既然实行，不忠实努力的做彻底就不罢休。别人一次就能做到了，我就学做一百次；别人十次就能做到了，我就学做一千次。果真能这样做，即使愚笨也一定会变聪明，即使柔弱也一定会变坚强。二十 AI Gong Sovereign of the State of LU asked about the way to govern the state.Replied Confucius, the government decrees of King Wen and King Wu of the Zhou Dynasty were put down in the codes and records. With the sent monarch and the virtuous ministers, decrees of King Wen and King Wu were enforced. Without such monarch and ministers, these decrees would be annulled.
The knack of choosing right persons is to discern and make proper use of those who are diligent in serving the state. The knack of utilizing the earth is to plant bushes and trees. Once the knack is known and put into effect, to govern the state is as easy as to plant cattle which grows fast. The crux of governing a state is to gather the able and virtuous around yourself. To gather them up, you have to well cultivate yourself. To well cultivate yourself, you have to act according to norms generally accepted under the heaven. To act according to norms generally accepted under the heaven, you have to follow the principle of benevolence. To be benevolent is to be human. To keep yourself close to the dear ones who love and esteem you is the greatest benevolence. To be righteous is to be fitting and proper. To respect the able and virtuous is the greatest righteousness. The different ways of keeping yourself close to the dear ones who love and esteem you, and the different ways of respecting the able and virtuous result from different requirements of etiquette. Therefore, those who occupy dominant positions have to well cultivate themselves. Those who want to well cultivate themselves have to attend on their parents. Those who want to attend on their parents have to ken out the reasons for respecting the able and virtuous and loving others. Those who want to know these reasons have to learn about the way of heaven. The great norms generally accepted under the heaven include five aspects whose realization depends upon three kinds of moral character. The relation between the monarch and his subjects. The relation between the father and the son, the relation between the husband and the wife, the relation between brothers, and contacts with friends are the five aspects. The three kinds of moral character of sagacity, charity and courage are generally respected under the heaven, and the conditions needed for manifesting such moral character are the same. People know the above in different ways, some by natural gift, some by learning and some by going through hardships, but the effects the acquisition of the knowledge brings about upon them are the same. People practice the above with different attitudes, some fail at ease and justified, some strive for benefits, and some are reluctant, but when they succeed in the practice, the effects the practice brings about upon them are the same. Said Confucius, one approaches the level of sagacity when he loves studying, one approaches the level of charity when he insists on doing good deeds, one approaches the level of courage when he has the sense of shame. When one has known these three points, he knows how to enhance his self-cultivation. When one has known how to enhance his self-cultivation, he knows how to administer the people as affairs. When one has known how to administer the people as affairs, he knows how to administer the country. There are nine canons affecting administering the country, enhancing self
cultivation, esteeming the able and virtuous, keeping oneself close to the dear ones, knowing the ministers, showing solicitude for officials, loving the people as one loves his sons, drumming for craftsmen, carrying out the policy of mollification in outlying districts and placating the feudal dukes and princes. To enhance self, cultivation is to achieve high moral standards. To esteem the able and virtuous enables one to avoid perplexedness when confronting problems. To keep oneself close to the dear ones prevents resentment among uncles and brothers. To honor the ministers makes one clear-headed in his work. To show solicitude for officials prods them to requite one with redoubled efforts. To love the people as one loves his sons inspires them to work more self-consciously, to drum for craftsmen. Brings about abundance of goods. To carry out the policy of mollification in outlying districts results in their coming over and pledging allegiance, and to placate the feudal dukes and princes impels all people under the heaven to revere the monarch. To keep a pious heart and a dignified look, and refuse to do anything inconsistent with etiquettes are ways to enhance self-cultivation. To dismiss those who speak ill of others, stay at a distance from beautiful women, despise wealth and value moral character are ways to appeal to the able and virtuous. To keep the dear ones, ranks of nobility venerated, raise their emoluments and have the same taste as theirs are ways to draw them to oneself. To leave sufficient subordinates at the minister's disposal is the way to encourage them to advise more. To keep one's word and let the official's high salary are ways to make them work harder. To impose on the people timely copay and low tax is the way to attract them. To pay the craftsmen wages and supply them food on the basis of daily and monthly investigation are ways to stimulate them to do their best. To see off those who depart and welcome those who arrive, praise those doing good deeds and sympathize with those lacking in capability are ways to mollify the people in outlying districts. To last the pedigree whose existence is at stake, revive the declining states, curb the riots, support those in perils, grant audiences and receive tributes on the right time, bestow more rewards and taking fewer tributes are ways to placate the feudal dukes and princes. The conditions needed for fulfilling the nine canons are the same. Preparedness ensures success, while unpreparedness spells failure. To be beforehand with one's words, one can prevent speaking haltingly. To be beforehand with the emerging problem, one can prevent frustration. To be beforehand with one's action, one can prevent making mistakes. To be beforehand with one's behavioral principle, one can prevent going into an impasse. If a subordinate is not in his superior's confidence, he can never administer the people's affairs.
There is a way to have the superior as confidence. One will not have it unless he has his friend's confidence. There is a way to have one's friend's confidence. One will not have it unless he is obedient to his parents. There is a way to be obedient to one's parents. One will not be so obedient unless he is honest. There is a way to be honest. One will not be honest unless he knows what good is. Honesty is the way of heaven. To be honest is the way of man. The saint displays natural honesty. He does so ungrudgingly. He achieves it without thinking, but his conduct is fit spontaneously for the standards set by the way of heaven. As for the ordinary men, they have to make choice of and adhere to the proper way to be honest, to study extensively, inquire meticulously, think cautiously, discern clearly and practice sincerely. If one is to study, he should never give up until he masters the subject he studies. If one is to inquire, he should never give up until he understands the question he inquires. If one is to think, he should never give up until he acquires a knowledge of what he thinks. If one is to discern, he should never give up until he makes a clear distinction between things. If one is to practice, he should never give up until he carries the doctrinal rhyme through to the end. When engaged in an activity, I should work it out by 100 times while others need only once. I shall work it out by 1,000 times while others need only 10 times. If this is really done, the ignorant will be intelligent, and the frail will be firm. 第21章 自成名 未知性，自明诚；未知教，诚则明矣，明则诚矣。经义，由于内心诚实而做到明察事理，这叫做天父的本性；由于明察事理而做到内心诚实，这叫做后天的教化。 做到内心诚实，就能做到明察事理了；而能够做到明察事理，也就能够做到内心诚实了。21. The sharp sightedness in discernment resulting from the innermost honesty is an innate nature. The innermost honesty resulting from the sharp sightedness in discernment is due to postnatal inculcation. When one is honest in his innermost being, he may well be sharp-sighted in discernment, and when one is sharp-sighted in discernment, he may well be honest in his innermost being. 第22章 为天下至诚，未能尽其性；能尽其性，则能尽人之性；能尽人之性，则可以赞天地之化育；可以赞天地之化育，则可以与天地参与。经义，只有天下最真诚的人。 才能够完全发挥个人的本性，能够完全发挥个人的本性，就能够完全发挥众人的本性，能够完全发挥万物的本性，能够完全发挥万物的本性，就能够帮助天地养育万物，能够帮助天地养育万物。
也就能够与天地相并列了。22.
Only the saint who is the most honest can develop his individuality to perfection. When his individuality fully developed, he can bring potentiality of the masses into full play in accordance with their inherent qualities. When the potentialities of the masses fully tapped, he can make the most of everything under heaven in accordance with their properties. When everything under heaven fully wielded, he can help the heaven and the earth grow and nourish everything. When everything is made to grow and nourish, he can stand side by side with the heaven and the earth.
第23章。 其次至趋，趋能有成，成则行。 行则者，者则明；明则动，动则变，变则化，为天下至诚未能化。今义次一等的人，则能从局部小事做起，从局部小事做起，也能做到内心诚实。做到内心诚实，就会表现出来；表现出来，就会变清楚。 变清楚就会光回明亮，光回明亮就会激励人心，激励人心就会改变人心，改变人心就会移风易俗。只有天下最诚实的人才能做到移风易俗。
23. Those who are second to the saint, though engaged in activities of minor importance, can also attain innermost honesty. When one is honest in his innermost being, he is bound to demonstrate his honesty. Honesty when demonstrated will illuminate and shine bright, then strike the hearts of the people and rainbow their mind. When it rainbow people as mind, it transforms the prevailing habits and customs. This task can only be fulfilled by the most honest.
第24章。至诚之道，可以前知。国家将兴，必有真祥；国家将亡，必有妖孽。见乎斯归，动乎四体。祸福将至，善。 必先知之，不善；必先知之，故至诚如神。经义做到极端诚实，可以预知未来。国家将要振兴的时候，一定会有吉祥的征兆；国家将要灭亡的时候，一定会有不祥的征兆。 这些征兆会在思草龟甲上表现出来，在四肢动作上反映出来。祸福将要降临时，好事一定会预先知道，坏事也一定会预先知道。所以，做到极端诚实，就会如同神灵一般。
24. When one is extremely honest, he foresees things to happen. Auspicious omens are seen when the country is going to prosper, and portentous omens are seen when the country is going to decline. Such omens appear on the divinatory herbs and tortoise shells, and reflecting how the related persons move their forelimbs. When a misfortune or a good luck is to befall, what will turn out to be good is foreknown, and so is what will turn out to be bad. Therefore, the extremely honest can be compared to supernatural beings.
第25章。诚者，自诚也；而道，自道也。诚者，物之终始；不诚，无物。 是故君子臣之为贵，臣者非自成己而已也，所以成物也。成己人也，成物之也，性之德也，和外内之道也，故识错之一也。今义所谓成，就是己成就自己；所谓道，就是自己引导自己。诚实贯穿事物的始终，没有诚实就没有万事万物。所以有良好品德修养的人把诚实看得特别宝贵。诚实并不是自己成就自己就算了的，还要用来成就万物。成就自己，这是人；成就万事，这是智。这种出自本性的德性，符合天地内外的规律，因而在任何时候加以实施都是适宜的。25 Honesty is the way by which one can consummate himself. Doctrine is the way by which one guides himself. Honesty underlies everything, from its beginning to its end.Without honesty, there can exist nothing. Therefore, a man of fine cultivation values honesty most. By honesty, one can consummate more than himself, he can consummate everything. To consummate oneself is benevolence, to consummate everything is sagacity.This virtue, resulting from one's natural instinct, accords with the law existing in and outside of the universe, so it is appropriate to pursue it at all times.
第二十六章，故至诚无习，不习则久，久则真，真则悠远，悠远则博厚，博厚则高明。博厚所以载物也，高明所以覆物也，悠久所以成物也。博厚配德，高明配天，悠久无疆。如此者，不见而彰，不动而变，无畏而成。今义所以极端诚实的品德是无止境的。无止境就能持久，持久就能有效验，有效验就能传之悠远，传之悠远就能广博深厚，广博深厚就能高大光明。广博深厚能够承载万物，高大光明能够覆盖万物，悠远长久能够造就万物。广博深厚可以与的比譬，高大光明可以与天比譬，悠远长久则可以无止境。这样一来，不用显示也能张明昭著，不用动作也能变化万物，没有作为也能自然成功。天地之道，可一言而尽也，其为物不二，则其生物不测。天地之道，博也，厚也，高也，明也，幽也，久也。今夫天，思昭昭之多，及其无穷也。日月星辰系焉，物复焉。今天的一撮土之多，及其广厚，载华岳而不重，震河海而不泄，万物载焉。今夫山，一卷石之多，及其广大，草木生之，禽兽居之，宝藏兴焉。今夫水，一勺之多，及其不测，圆沱蛟龙鱼鳖生焉，货财直焉。今义天地的规律，可以用一句话说尽。由于他自身专诚不二，所以他造就万物也就奥妙无穷。
天地的规律实在是广博那、厚那、高大那、光明那、悠远那、长久那。现在且说天吧，那不过是一小片一小片光明聚成的，到了无穷无尽的程度，日月星辰悬挂在它上面，万物都覆盖在它下面。说到地，它不过是一小把一小把泥土聚成的，到了宽广深厚的程度，负载着西岳华山也不敢倒重，容纳了黄河大海也不会泄漏，物都负担在它身。再说山，它不过是拳头大拳头大的石块聚成的，到了广阔巨大的程度，草木生长在上面，禽兽居住在上面，宝藏也能从那里挖掘出来。至于水，它不过是一勺一勺的水聚成的，到了深不可测的程度，圆陀蛟龙鱼鳖生长在那里，货物财富也从那里产生出来。诗云：为天之命，愚目不已。盖曰天之所以为天也，愚乎不显，文王之德之纯。盖曰文王之所以为文也，纯亦不已。经义，诗经上说，上天之道完美伟大而永无休止呢，这便是说天所以成其为天的道理。又说多么光明呢，周文王的品德是这样的纯正无瑕，这便是说周文王所以的是好为文的缘故。周文王品德的纯正无瑕也如同天道那样永无休止。26 The virtue of extreme honesty never ceases to exist. As it never ceases to exist, it is lasting. As it is lasting, it is efficacious. As it is efficacious,it is to be handed down to distant future. As it is to be handed down to distant future, it is extensive and deep. As it is extensive and deep, it is lofty and bright. It is extensive and deep, so it bears all things under heaven. It is lofty and bright, so it covers all things under heaven.It is permanent, so it brings up all things under heaven. It is so extensive and deep that it matches the earth, so lofty and bright that it matches the heaven, so permanent that it will last forever. Thus, without making a show, it is clear for all to see, without making a movement.It transforms all things, without making an effort, it succeeds in doing anything. The way of the universe can be described in a single sentence, as it is constant to taking honesty as the only proper course, its way of bringing up all things is extremely subtle.The way of the universe is extensive, deep, lofty, bright, permanent and everlasting. The heaven is no more than an amassment of pieces of brightness, but, at its infinitude, it holds the sun, the moon and all stars above, and covers all things beneath.The earth is no more than an amassment of handfuls of soil, but, at its vastness, it bears Mount Washa, the western sacred mountain without strenuosity, contains the Yellow River and the sea without discharging, and carries all things.The mountain is no more than an amassment of pieces of stones, but, at its immensity,
Plants grow thereon, animals live thereon, and precious mineral deposits can be unearthed therein. The sea is no more than an amassment of spoonfuls of water, but, in its recesses, different kinds of turtles, alligators, dragons and fishes live therein, and various resources are produced therefrom. It is said in the Book of Psalms, the way of the heaven is perfect and endless. That explains the way how the heaven is. It is said again, how glorious the pure character of King Wen is. That explains the reason why he was conferred the posthumous title of Wen, which means refined. The impeccability of his character will shine as endlessly as the way of the heaven.
第27章。 大哉， 圣人之道。 洋洋乎， 发育万物， 聚集于天。 悠悠大哉， 礼仪三百， 威仪三千， 待其人而后行。 故曰， 苟不至德， 至道不明焉。 故君子尊德性而道问学， 至广大而敬精微， 极高明而道中庸。 温故而知新， 敦厚以崇礼。 是故， 居上不骄， 位下不备。 国有道， 其言足以兴， 国无道， 其末足以荣。 诗曰， 既明且哲， 以保其身， 其辞之谓语。 今义， 圣人处世立身的原则， 真是伟大呀， 真是浩荡无边啊。 他养育万物， 和天一样崇高， 他是多么宽和伟大呀。 规定的礼仪有300条， 规定的威仪有3000条。 一定要等到圣人出现以后才能实行。 所以说， 如果不是在最好德行的人， 最伟大的处世法则是不能形成的。 因此， 有道德的人遵从德行品性， 进行询问学习， 做到既博大又十分精细透彻， 踏到极其崇高， 极其光明的境界， 遵循不偏不倚， 无过无不及的中庸之道， 温习旧的学问， 认识新的道理， 品性敦厚， 崇尚礼智。 因而能做到居处上位时不骄横， 居处下位时不背叛， 国家政治清明的时候就发表政见， 足可以得到任用， 国家政治黑暗的时候就沉默不语， 也足能够借以容身。 诗经里说， 既明达又智慧， 以此来保全自身， 大概就是说的这个意思吧。 27. How great the saint as way of conducting himself is. It is so mighty that it may make all things flourish, and as sublime as the heaven. The range it covers is so wide that it includes 300 items of ceremonials and 3,000 items of manners. These prevail only after the advent of the saint. The greatest way of conducting oneself cannot be formed without the man of highest morality. Therefore, a man of high morality values one as virtue and is diligent in learning, so he has both extensive knowledge and profound scholarship. He attains the most sublime and brilliant realm of thought by following his unbiased doctrine of the mean.
He gains new insights through reviewing what he had learned. He is honest and sincere and observant of etiquette. Hence, he is not imperious when he is in a superior position, and does not deviate from his way when he is in an inferior position. He expresses his political views to obtain appointment to an office when the state is properly run. He remains silent to be tolerable when the rule is dark. That means the same as is said in the Book of Psalms, be worldly wise and play safe.
第28章。 子曰：“愚而好自用，见而好自专，生乎今之事，反古之道，如此者，在及其身者也。”经义。孔子说：愚笨却喜欢自以为是，卑贱却喜欢独专行，生活在当今的社会，却要恢复古代的做法，这样的人，灾祸就会落到他身上。 非天子不以礼，不制度，不考文。今天下，车同轨，书同文，行同文。虽有其位，苟无其德，不敢作礼乐焉；虽有其德，苟无其位，亦不敢作礼乐焉。今义，如果不是天子，就不要议定礼仪。 不要创立法度，不要考核文字。现在天下车子两轮间的距离相同，书写的文字相同，行为上道德规范相同。即便有天子的地位，但如果没有极好的品德，就不敢制定礼乐制度；即便有极好的品德。 但如果没有天子的地位，那也不敢制定礼乐制度。子曰：“吾说下礼，其不足真也；吾学殷礼，有宋存焉；吾学周礼，今用之，无从周。”经义。孔子说：“我能解说下代的礼。” 但他的后代岂国所行的礼制不足以作证明？我学习殷代的礼，有他的后代宋国保存着这些礼制；我学习周代的礼，现在实行它，我遵从周礼。28 said
Confucius, calamity is imminent to the one who is ignorant but self-willed, humble but arbitrary. Lives in the present world but insists on restoring the ancient system. One who is not the son of heaven should not lay down rights, nor should he make laws and moral standards, nor should he study and examine the commonly used characters. At present, people have the same vehicle gauges, use the same characters and pursue the same ethical code. If one has the status of the Son of Heaven, but lacks high morality, he dares not to draw up the ritual and musical systems. If one has high morality, but lacks the status of the Son of Heaven, he dares not to draw up the ritual of musical systems. Said Confucius, I can interpret the rites of the Xia dynasty, but the rites of its descendant state of Qin were not exemplary. I study the rites of the Yin dynasty which were maintained by its descendant state of Song. I study the rites of the Zhou dynasty which are practiced today, and of which I am observant.
第29章。 王天下有三重焉，其寡过矣乎？上焉者，虽善无争，无争不信，不信民服从。 下焉者，虽善不尊，不尊不信，不信民服从。故君子之道，本诸身，真诸庶民，考诸三王而不谋，见诸天地而不备，执诸鬼神而无疑，百世以祀圣人而不惑。执诸鬼神而无疑，知天也；百世以祀圣人而不惑，知人也。是故，君子动而是为天下道，行而是为天下法，言而是为天下则，远之则有望，近之则不厌。今义统治天下有议定礼仪，创立法度，考核文字这三件重要的事情要做，能做好这三件事，大概就很少会有过错了吧。在上位的人，虽然他确定的行为准则很好，但是却没有得到真验，没有得到真验，人民就不相信，人民不相信，也就不会遵从。在下位的人，虽然他确定的行为准则很好，但是他的地位又不尊贵，地位不尊贵，人民就不相信，人民不相信，也就不会遵从。所以统治天下的人，他确立行为准则必须先以自身为依据，再从人民那里得到真验，对照查考下周三代先望而没有错误，树立在天地之间而不违背常理，求证于鬼神而没有疑惑，待到百代之后圣人出现也不会有疑问。求证于鬼神而没有疑惑，这是知道了天意，百代以后圣人出现也不会有疑问，这是掌握了人情。所以统治天下的人，他的举动可以是世代代为天下人所遵循，他的行为可以是世代代为天下人的法度，他的言论可以是世代代为天下人的准则。离他远的时候瞻仰崇敬他，靠他近的时候也不厌烦他。诗曰：在彼无恶，在此无赦，树基素业，以永终欲。君子未有不如此，而早有欲于天下者也。今义诗经上说，在那里没有人厌恶，在这没有人嫌弃，几乎是日夜努力，以便永远保持自己的荣誉。作为一个统治天下的人，如果不这样去做，就不可能早早的在天下享有美誉。29 To lay down rights, to make laws and to examine characters are the important contents of ruling over a country. There will be few faults upon the completion of the triplex.Good as the ethical code set by the great kings of past dynasties, it is not verifiable today, people do not believe it, and, consequently, do not observe it. Good as the ethical code set by the sages, his political status is not very high, people do not believe it.And consequently, do not observe it. Therefore, when the ruler of a country sets an ethical code, he must earnestly practice it first, then verify it through people as practice, and measure it by the standards of the kings of the Xia Shen and Zhou dynasties to see that it is faultless.That it will not go against the normality in the universe, that it will not arouse suspicion when asking for advices from the supernatural beings,
that it will not be questionable at the advent of another saint after 100 generations. That it will arouse no suspicion when asking for advices from the supernatural beings shows that the ruler is aware of the will of the heaven. That it will not be questionable at the advent of another saint after 100 generations shows that the ruler realizes the human feelings. So the ruler's activities will be followed as examples by the succeeding generations. His conduct will set up standards for the succeeding generations, and his expressed opinions on public affairs will be regarded as criteria by the succeeding generations. People of the distant future will respect him, and his contemporaries never detest him. It is said in the Book of Songs, there, no one abhors him, here, no one cold shoulders him. He works hard day and night to preserve his repute for long. A ruler failing to do so is not likely to win early the great renown in the country.
第30章 仲尼祖述尧舜 现章文武，上虑天时，下习水土。譬如天地之无不载，无不复仇；譬如四时之错行，如日月之带明。万物并育而不相害，道并行而不相悖。小德川流，大德敦化。此天地之所以为大也。经义。 孔子效法唐尧、虞舜，以周文王、周武王为典范，上顺天时变化，下顺风土人情，就好比天地那样，没有什么不被他覆盖着，没有什么不被他覆盖着，就如同四时更迭变化，就如同日月更替明亮。 万物一起生长却不相互损害，各种规律同时并行而不彼此违背。小的德行如同山川流水浸润万物，大的德行使万物醇厚敦实，这就是天地所以伟大的道理。30 Confucius followed the examples of Yan and Shang, the ancient sages, and modeled himself on King Wen and King Wu, the saint monarchs. He complied with the change of times, and conformed to the natural conditions and social customs. His virtue is analogous to the universe which bears all things and covers all things, and is as natural as the change of seasons or the alternating shining of the sun and the moon. All things exist together but never harm each other, always function together but never go against each other. Virtues of minor significance are like rivers nourishing things in their valleys. Virtues of major significance are basics nourishing all things. That describes the mightiness of the universe. 第31章为天下至圣，未能聪明睿智，足以有灵也；宽裕温柔，足以有容也；发强刚毅，足以有直也；斋庄中正。 足有敬也，文理密察，足以有别也。经义，只有天下最圣明的人，能够做到聪明智慧，足可以君临天下；能够做到宽宏大度，温和柔顺，足可以包容万物；能够做到奋发顽强，刚毅果敢。 足可以决断大事，能够做到尽素庄重，正直无邪，足可以赢得尊敬，能够做到有文采有条理，精密详明，足可以辨别是非，朴薄渊泉而实出之，朴薄如天，渊泉如渊，见而明默不敬，言而明默不信，行而明默不说，是以声名扬溢乎中国，诗集满末，舟车所至，人力所通，天之所覆，地之所载，日月所照，双目所对，凡有邪气者，莫不尊亲，故曰配天。今义他的美德广博幽深，并时时表现出来，像天一样宽广博大，像渊一样水深流长，表现出的举止，人民没有不尊敬的，说出来的话，人民没有不相信的，做出来的事，人民没有不喜悦的。因此他的好名声传遍了全中国，一直传到四境边远地区，凡是车船能够到达的地方，人力所能交往的地方，天所覆盖的地方，地所覆载的地方，日月所照耀的地方，霜露所降落的地方，凡是有邪气的生物，没有不尊敬他、亲近他的，所以说他能够与天地相比拟。31 Only the saint can be wise and erudite enough to reign over the country, magnanimous and mild enough to embrace all things, tenacious and resolute enough to decide upon major issues, solemn and just enough to win respects from others, and make his writings rich, well organized and accurate enough to distinguish the right from the wrong. His virtue is extensive and deep, and manifests itself at all times. It is as extensive as the heaven, as deep as the abyss. All the people cannot but honor his conduct. All the people cannot but believe in what he says, and all the people cannot but delight at what he does. His good repute spreads far and wide in the country, into the outlying districts. In places where vehicles and boats go and humans travel, in places under the heaven and on the earth, in places with shines of the sun and the moon, and moistened by frost and dew, all the courageous and upright esteem and keep themselves close to him. Therefore he can be matched with the heaven and the earth. 32 为天下之臣，未能经纶天下之代经，立天下之大本，知天地之化育，夫焉有所以？谆谆其人，渊渊其渊，浩浩其天。苟不顾聪明甚之达天德者，其孰能知之？今义只有天下最诚实的人，能够统领天下根本大法，树立天下根本大德，明了天地生成变化。难道是他另有什么依赖吗？只是因为他有真挚恳诚的仁厚，就像渊一样幽深，就像天一样广阔。如果不是确实聪明甚达，具备天下大德的人，怎么能明白这一切呢？32 Only the most honest can uphold the fundamental human relations in the country, exemplify and foster the fundamental virtue in the country, and understand the growth and development of the universe.
What does he rely on when doing such? It is merely due to his sincere and earnest benevolence, which is as deep as the abyss, as vast as the heaven. Save the one with genuine omniscience and consummate virtue, how could anyone else understand all this?
第33章。 诗曰：“衣锦上窘，恶其闻之者也。” 故君子之道，黯然而日彰；小人之道，得然而日亡。 君子之道，淡而不厌，简而闻，温而理，知远知近，知风知字，知为之险，可与入得矣。今义。 《诗经》上说：“身穿锦服又加罩衫，这是因为讨厌那锦绣文采太显眼。”所以，品德高尚的人，他的为人之道是力图隐蔽不露，但结果却使美德日益昭彰；品德低下的人，他的为人之道是竭力求得表面上品德昭著。 但结果却日渐消亡。品德高尚的人，他的为人之道是平淡却不令人厌烦，简朴却有文采，温和而有条理，见彼而知此，见外而知内，见为而知者，能做到这一步，便可以跨人道德之门了。诗云：“前虽弗已，亦恐之招。” 故君子内省不咎，无恶于志。君子之所不可及者，其为人之所不见乎？今义，《诗经》上说：“鱼儿潜水藏的深，人们还是看得清。”所以品德高尚的人， 自我反省而没有什么使他感到不安的，没有什么玷污他的志向的。别人赶不上品德高尚者的地方，大概只是他们在吃人看不见的时候够谨慎小心吧。诗云：“乡在耳室，尚不愧于屋漏。”故君子不动而静，不言而信。 经义，《诗经》上说：“看你身居房间中，也应慎独无愧心。”所以品德高尚的人，他即使没有任何举动，表现也是恭敬的；即使不说话，内心也是诚实的。诗曰：“奏假如言，实名有真。”是故君子不赏而明劝， 不怒而临危于夫乐。经义，《诗经》上说：“默默敬献，没有争执。”所以居统治地位的人，不用赏赐，人民也能尽力；不用发怒，人民比用刀斧刑罚还感到恐惧。诗曰：“不显为德，百辟其行之。” 是故君子笃公而天下平。经义，《诗经》上说：“赫赫美德大发扬，百国诸侯齐效仿。”居统治地位的人敦厚恭，敬天下就会太平。诗云：“予怀明德，不大声以色。”子曰：“声色之余以化名，莫也。” 诗曰：“德有如毛，毛有有伦。”上篇之载，无声无秀。至矣。经义，《诗经》上说：“我怀有好的品德，就不用立身立色。”孔子说：“靠立身立色去改造人民，那是莫等的本领。”《诗经》上说： 德行感化，轻便如毛。那毛虽是轻小细微，但还是有东西可以与它相比。 而上天办事真微妙，无声无味静悄悄，真是到了至高无上的境界了。
33. It is said in the Book of Songs, cover your brocaded robe with an overall. This shows the disgust at the conspicuous garishness. And man of noble character is under no circumstances given to showing off, but his virtue is seen increasingly clear. And man of vile character strives to make himself well reputed, which only makes himself increasingly flagrant. The way the man of noble character conducts himself is flat, but not boring, plain, but graceful, mild, but orderly, and he sees another point from the point in sight, sees the interior from the exterior, sees the future development from one small clue. When one conducts himself in such a way, he crosses the threshold of high morality. It is said in the Book of Songs, hidden deep in water, fish are still seeable. When a man of noble character introspects, he has nothing to regret and finds nothing tarnishing his aspirations. What a man of noble character outweighs others is that he is always circumspect, even when he is out of sight of anyone else. It is said in the Book of Songs, when you are alone in your room, still you should do nothing that will bring qualms upon self-examination. A man of noble character is always respectable, even when he is not doing anything, and always sincere, even when he is not saying anything. It is said in the Book of Songs, making efforts quietly causes no trouble. So, the ruler of a country should make his people do all they can, even if without granting them rewards, and keep them in greater awe than by punishment, even if without showing them his indignation. It is said in the Book of Songs, when the monarch displays his virtue, all the feudal dukes and princes will follow his example. Peace will reign under heaven if the man who rules the country is honest, sincere and deferential. It is said in the Book of Songs, with noble character, I need not to be stern in voice and countenance. Said Confucius, it is least desirable to cultivate people through stern voice and countenance. It is said in the Book of Songs, to cultivate people by one, as virtue is as light as to raise a feather. Light and minute as the feather is, it has its comparatives, but the heaven performs everything soundlessly and tracelessly, it accomplishes the supreme good.